And now let's look at multiple regressions real quick. So we can also use more than one predictor. And if we have more than one predictor, what we're basically doing is we're spanning a plane. So a linear model is a plane in the three-dimensional area, which could look like this if we one of the values is zero, or like this if the other one is zero, or it could be a linear combination of these two kinds of plates, and we also have the offset here. Okay, so often you will have more than one predictor variable, and the framework of stats models linear regressions formula API simply extends naturally to this scenario. So let's look at a real world weather data set to see if the amount of precipitation relates to other factors. So for that, we import the Seattle weather dataset from VGA datasets. And let's first look at some of the pair plots here to see if we can spot any correlations in there. Now we see, for example, that, well, what is this? It's minimum and maximum temperature. Well, minimum and maximum temperature correlate. That kind of makes sense. And yeah, they do again. The others are not as obvious in correlations. Okay, but how do we do now a linear model where we have more than one predictor, where we simply have a plus on the predictor side? So now we want to predict precipitation from the max temp and the wind. And if we do that, what we're getting is we're getting two slopes. So if we look at this, this makes sense. So we have the slope, which talks about the height here. And then for these two variables, we will have a slope in our three-dimensional space. Okay, and for these both, we have, well, obviously we have the actual coefficient, and we also have p-values for these both. And according to stats models here, the max temp and the wind are both significant. Even though the max temp is not, so the effect size of the max temp is not as high as the effect size of the wind here, for example. And both of these explain only 13% variance, which is really, really not much. And now we can plot this even using stats models plot fit function. So it's simply a utility to compare the prediction of a model with the data. So the wet one is what we fitted using the max temp and the wind here, or rather the only taking out the wind from that. And these here are the actual scattered plots for the precipitation. Okay, so we see that our model would fit something like this, and it doesn't explain close. So it's not close at representing the entire hidden structure in this data set. So by the way, how does this look under the hood? Well, under the hood, I told you at the very beginning that that stats models creates design matrices using PETSI. And in our first example, we had a 100 by 2 design matrix. And if we now have two predictors, we simply have a 100 by 3 design matrix, right? Such that we have now a new column in our design matrix, which then gives us values for a new predictor. Okay, so yeah, we see here that as the wind increases, kind of the precipitation does too, but well, not really. And then next up, how do we add categorical data? Well, categorical data needs some transformation to be included in a linear regression, because for categories, you cannot simply add a new column to the design matrix. That's not how it works. So a common way of how to do that is to use one hot encoding, where for each category we add a new variable, and if a data belongs to that category, the variable is one, else zero. And that's what PETSI even does. If we use, so weather here is a categorical variable with drizzle, rain, sun, snow, and fog being the values, and if we simply add that here to our linear regression, what PETSI and thus stats models also under the hood does, it creates a one hot encoding for each of the weather conditions. Each of the weather conditions, you asked? No, not all of them, but one less, because if all of these are zero, this doesn't mean there's no weather, but it means there's the one condition which is not met, which is not listed here in the columns, which is the drizzle one. Okay, so if rain is one, then the weather was rain. If snow is one, the weather would be snow. And if all are zero, the weather would be drizzle. This sometimes makes sense. In an experiment, you're likely to have some base condition which makes sense to be encoded as zero. Alright? In the weather, this is not the case, and you could also specify that you don't want this to be encoded that way and to have a one-hot encoding also for the drizzle condition here. That's the way stats models does it standardly, and it doesn't change too much. Why? Because you can encode that in the intercept, because the intercept is also there, and we can encode one categorical variable also in the intercept. So this fixed value that is either one or zero gives an extra intercept. So for each of those values, we have an extra line or fit plot, which are all in parallel. So let's, we looked at the design matrix. And now, in terms of a linear regression, we can think now of a parallel line with a different onset being added for each category. So we now have, if we look at, the summary here, we see that now we have a bunch of more stuff. For example, sun here does not seem to be significant at all, whereas fog and rain are significant. Well, who knew that rain is significant for precipitation? And if we now look at the plot fit here, we see that we simply have more lines here which are parallel, because they are simply offset by the categories. And that's how in stats models and generally in linear models, categorical variables are encoded. They can't decide over the slope, because slopes can be calculated only by continuous data, but they can calculate over an intercept, which then makes the extra line or fit plot, which are all in parallel. And now let's get to the very last topic of this week's lecture, and that is interactions. So it can be that the influence of a predictor changes in the presence of another predictor. So, for example, that the influence of wind is different depending if it's sunny or not. And to do that, so to encode the interaction of two predictors, we can do that in PETSI and in stats models using the colon in the formula. So the result is a new variable gets added, which is the product of the interacting variables. So now if we do that, we see that we have all combinations of wind and the categorical weather here added to our design matrix. We can also, so now we're adding wind and weather and the interaction of wind and weather. And there's simply a shorthand syntax for this, which is wind times weather, which does not more than simply adding wind plus weather plus wind colon weather. And now we can fit again. And now we see that we have many, many insignificant extra values and new lines here, additional lines that have extra slope, because the interaction of a categorical one and a continuous one can have now its own intercept and slope. So now we have more lines which are not only in parallel. So now this would be, for example, one where it's sunny and, well, values depending on wind, and this would be one where it's drizzle and depending on wind. Actually, the drizzle one would be the default one, basically. Yeah, but we see that many of these here are insignificant. So this is insignificant, this is. So we now have many insignificant values, and we see using our fit plot that it's still not that well explained. And all of this to say, the weather is really hard to predict. So yes. if we look at the explained variance here, it's now 30%, so it's more than when we only used the wind here, where it was only 13%, but it's still not that high. All right, and then I have one last exercise for you, and that is that you should ignore for now that the tips dataset does not really satisfy the assumptions for linear regression, but make a multiple regression to explain the amount of tip even better. So additionally, use now the variable day, smoker, and size, and the interaction between smoker and size. Does it make sense to include those additional predictors? Three, two, one. So we simply have total bill plus day plus smoker times size to include smoker, size, and the interaction between smoker and size. If we look at it now, we have an R squared of 47%. So let's look at our tips fit.summary, which we had before. It was called fit tips. And if we look at this here, we had 45% explained variance. So adding them doesn't make a lot of sense. And if we look at the p-values here, we see that many of them are insignificant, except again our total bill, which we had before. So a lot of the p-values are bigger than 0.05, and also the increase in the explained variance is not too high. So I would say it does not make sense to include those additional predictors. All right, so I hope now you learned to trust linear regression only when it actually makes sense to trust linear regression, and you understood a bit of the concepts underlying it. So unfortunately we didn't have enough time to cover all the statistics required to successfully analyze experiments now in one lecture, and like I said, there's more to it: generalized linear models, linear mixed effect models, ANOVAs, time series analysis, Bayesian statistics. So the first three all fit under the framework of linear models, which is a really, really nice framework. And I encourage you to keep an eye open for courses from the NBP at our university. In the past, there was, for example, a course on applied generalized linear models, which is really great because it also takes this approach of there is only one test, and that is then this linear model. And also I have further readings, or rather further watchings, which are a bunch of videos here. And what I really like is the Statistics for Hackers talk by Jake Vanderplas, which I also showed you a bit of here, which is really nice, the computational approach to statistics. And the other ones are also really useful as introduction, for example, for Bayesian statistics here, and so on and so on. All right, with that, I see you next week.